立法會主席。
President. We resume the second part of the debate. Mr. Leung Yu-chung. President, CY Leung, from the time he took office to today, kept saying that housing remains his top priority, and he's coming to the end of his term. He failed to make good on his promises in so many areas, but I think we would expect some achievements in the housing policy, which is his top priority. Regrettably, in the way of housing policy, we can only encapsulate it in one single word: a failure. He didn't make any improvement. If anything, he did worse than the previous administration. And he is shoving the problems to the next administration, all that he promised. In his policy address, he is harping on the old tune without any new ideas. The secretary said in one of the panel meetings that to resolve housing problem, we need to increase supply, in particular public housing supply. President, this is stating the obvious. This is a load of nonsense. Who doesn't know that we can only build a way out of the housing problem? Why is it that the administration in this term fails to achieve that, to meet the demand? CY Leung, when they ran for office, did pledge that the waiting time for PRH would be 3 years. As we all know, at the present moment, it is 4.7 years instead of 3 years. So isn't the problem getting worse? He also pledged that within his five-year tenure, he's going to build 75,000 PRH units. But at the present moment, as of now, for the past 4 years, he managed 51,000 only, 24,000 short. This year, do you think that they will be able to achieve the target of 24,000 remaining in his patch? So we can see that it is difficult for him to pull it off. In his policy address, CY Leung said that for 5 years from 2016-17, there will be 71,800 units to be coming on stream. That's PRH units. But in last year's policy address, he said in the coming 5 years, there should be 76,700. So there will be a shortfall of 5,000, even if he managed to achieve his target this year. Now, every time he made the pledges, he failed to honor them. And he's really making regressive steps. To address the housing problem, we have to build more. We have to achieve a bigger production. We failed to achieve that. What about the private sector housing? Now, the private sector housing has been peaking out in prices year after year. We're hitting all-time historically high. Now, some surveys suggest that the median housing prices would be 19 times of the median income of the people of Hong Kong, the most expensive the world over. Housing is one of the most important daily necessities. It is one of our fundamental rights. Now, this is something that is exercising a lot of people, and people simply cannot start their families without being able to buy their own homes. And people will be toiling hard all life for their property. They'll be burdened, overburdened with the mortgage payment all their life. And people would be casting aside their interests, their passion, and they would be just busy making money in order to buy their own homes and get on the housing ladder. Now, why? How else? Why? This is the reason why the young people are seething with anger and resentment. Now, people simply cannot save up enough for the mortgage, but they're too rich to be qualified for PRH housing. They're left, they're falling between two stools, and they have no option but move into the subdivided flats in squalid condition. There are 88,000 SDUs in Hong Kong, but this is not the same as the actual figure in society. Now, let's just take these 88,000, for instance. In the policy address, in 5 years, there will be 70,000 public housing flats. Now, even if we allocate them all to those in the SDUs, this will not be enough. For Hong Kong people, in particular the younger generation, how can they look for accommodation? What avenues are open to them? Presently, the government simply cannot address all these problems. Unfortunately, the senior officials are reluctant to shoulder the responsibility. All they do would be to pass the buck. Mr. Professor Anthony Cheung told us not to drag on the matter for any reason. President, it is our duty to give a voice to the public and to keep the government on the toes and highlight all the problems. Of course, we have the obligation to suggest solutions. But has the government heeded our views? Has the government reflected upon our solutions? I don't think the administration should continuously ask people to shut up in the face of all these problems. Now, we cannot build any housing stock in one single day, and there are so many people who are in dire straits. The administration should adopt a multi-pronged approach and map out short, medium, and long-term solutions to the problems. Like, for instance, we have to bring in the rent control. We have made a specific recommendation that we can draw a line at certain rateable value. Anything beyond that will not be subject to rent control. We can have flexibility, but the government is rejected this point blank. Now, we suggested temporary housing, but the government rejected this point blank as well. We suggested redeveloping the old housing estates. The government rejected this point blank because this would affect the queue, those on the waiting list. We're not suggesting redeveloping the entire housing estate. We can do this block by block, and that would alleviate the disruption to the queue, and we can have a dual-track approach. The government rejected this point blank. Brownfields, there are so many problems that the government said have to be studied. President, we floated so many ideas, but the government just rejected them all, point blank. Now, when they rejected ideas point blank, what specific better solutions does the government up its sleeve? We draw a blank there. The government is not determined to resolve the problems. What is making us angry is CY Leung has been resorting to all these little tricks, and he's dividing Hong Kong. In his policy address, he is trying to take advantage of the country park areas, which he thinks are of inferior quality, and build public housing and old folks' homes there. I think this is not solving the problem. This is causing unnecessary arguments in the community. And he is pitting these needy people against those who want to defend the country parks. He is thinking of all these solutions that will cause bickering and arguments. It's not the case we are running out of space for development, but a lot of these space that can be used is dominated by the rural powers, the dark forces. CY Leung never put livelihood uppermost on his mind. He keeps saying that his priority is housing. In fact, this is a tool for political struggle in order to defend the interests of the vested interests. He is causing division. He is tearing society asunder. What good does it do to Hong Kong's future? I very much hope that the next administration will halt the Chi-wai Leung policies. Whoever becomes the candidates for the CE should get rid of the repressive and domineering attitude of Chi-wai Leung. They should be humbly or modestly heeding public opinions and resolve all the problems. Mr. Chen Kingbo, President, the policy address addresses a lot of public problems, and there are so many recommendations. I'm going to air my views in all the time I have. Let's say something about the insurance issues of which I am concerned. For the MPF, the next idea would be to build the MPF platform and to standardize all the administrative procedures and streamline them in order to lower the costs, to pave the way for full portability. I've been urging for the streamlining of the administrative procedures. One of the reasons why the fees are so high is because of the high administrative costs. And this has to do with the sheer amount of manpower and paperwork that will be involved. Let me say, cite an example for the core fund. Now, it is going to be launched. A lot of employees have received a document like this. Some have received a few. Each containing a dozen or so pages, a million or so documents have been mailed to the users, and all these courts would be factored in. The mail cost is more than $10 million, and let alone the printing costs. There are so many administrative procedures that will be handled manually. They have to handle the paperwork. The compliance costs would be exorbitantly high, and the admin costs would be exceedingly high. So the trade has been urging for the government to streamline the administrative procedures. We welcome this EMPF platform. We hope that this will happen as soon as possible to keep the costs down. In order to encourage all the stakeholders to embrace the EMPF platform, the government should consider allowing the sector to run this system. Turning to the cost, at the moment it is 1.75%. But the sector told me that the actual cost would be even lower. It is more like 1.4%. The MPFA hasn't affected in the refund and the discounts. In a lot of the schemes, that they have the discounts and the concession. I mean, the percentage is not reflecting the actual percentage. I hope that the MPFA will announce the scale of fees and increase the transparency and reflect the actual situation. The other focus of attention is the VHIS, Voluntary Health Insurance Scheme. The policy address refers all the specific arrangements, and those acquiring policies will be given tax concession. This discussion has spanned two administrations. We have the fundamental consensus. I hope that this will be brought in as soon as possible to benefit the middle class, and people would use the private hospital more to free up the public hospitals. For the high risk pool, the government should consider the long term commitment and come up with measures to allow people in the high risk pool to be able to take out an insurance. Tax deduction for insurance. I hope that we'll be able to announce the details next week. This is only the beginning, and I hope that the tax deduction can be extended to other insurance, like annuity, health, and other forms of insurance policies. I've urged people to look after themselves, and I mean, the government will only be shelling out a little bit of money to lure people to buy the insurance policy. And this is this is going to be good for the administration in the long run. The voluntary insurance has become part of the healthcare reform. The government is not doing this seriously enough.
The government must improve or work on the deficiencies of the healthcare sector, and they must control the increasing healthcare costs. And healthcare inflation is far higher than the general inflation. If we cannot control the healthcare inflation, then the medical costs will continue to rise. So in terms of reforming Hong Kong's private healthcare system, the government must continue its work. And according to the policy address, the Trade Development Council must continue to promote Hong Kong's financial services. They will certainly, I trust that they will promote the insurance sector in the Belt and Road context. And we are waiting for the insurance authority to begin its work. And when establishing the bill, the government made a number of oral commitments and a number of issues have to be clarified. For example, the requirements on the interests of agents and appeals mechanism, etc. The government must follow on the work and alleviate the worries of the insurance sector so that all insurance practitioners can be rightly protected and at the same time protect the interests of customers. And in the policy address, it is proposed that offsetting would be cancelled phase by phase, for example, by providing exemptions. And I agree that the government should shoulder part of the blame or part of the burden of the employers in order to help the SMEs. I think the government must achieve middle ground so that both employers and employees can benefit. If we do not make compromise, then no one would win. So hopefully the government can come up with a win-win solution for all. And if necessary, the government should enhance support towards SMEs. And under old age living allowance, another new tier has been proposed in the policy address, and I welcome such move by the government. And I also suggest maintaining the existing social assistance scheme with means testing, and the scope is very wide as to whether the subsidy levels are adequate. The government should continue to review the situation. The government should waive the MPF contributions of the elderly because those are the long-time savings of the elderly people, and they should be exempted. The policy address also touched upon land development and conservation. It suggested incorporating more sites of ecological value into our country parks, and at the same time, sites of lower ecological value should be used for development and housing. And I agree with such land exchange arrangements, and indeed, there is some flexibility, and there's certainly room for discussion. I also support land reclamation outside of the Victoria Harbour, and in the policy address, Siu Ho Wan, Ma Liu Sui, and the studies for reclamation would be completed by this year. And there's also a proposal to reclaim land at Sunny Bay, and I hope that the government will be bold. And I'd also like to talk about sport. The government proposes sport facilities, and in the next 5 years, 26 sport projects or developments would be proposed with a total value of $20 billion. And this would only promote healthy development of our society. With high living pressure, a lot of people lack exercising, and their mental and physical health would suffer. A lot of young people addicted to the online world, and they refuse to make friends outside. By offering more sport and leisure facilities, the government can promote a culture of sport to promote the health of its citizens, and through sport, young people can also socialize more and benefit. The $20 billion investment is certainly worthwhile. In terms of a work-life balance, the government should do more to promote it. The government has such concept in place, but they have done too little. They should mobilize different departments and allow their staff to have a balanced life so that parents would have time for their children. This way, we can promote happy families and a harmonious society. And for the incoming chief executive, whoever that might be, that should be the focus. We have a very healthy financial reserve, and I'm sure the government is well positioned to do more and promote happy families. The government should certainly pay attention to that, and so I speak. Mr. Yu Si-wing. President, under the policy address that was mentioning of land planning, including short, medium to long-term measures, for example, land reclamation in new territories, development of underground areas, conservation of sites, and these are moves to increase land supply. And the Secretary wants to explore new sites, and we can see his commitment to increasing land supply. In terms of short to medium-term land supply, the current term administration is committed, however, limited by factors such as filibustering at LegCo and land supply. Even though the supply is short of the target, they have laid the foundation for the incoming administration. We feel that this is a committed policy address in terms of tackling housing issues, and one day our land supply would run out, so we have to plan ahead. We need to find new alternatives on top of our existing sites, and we face the issue of inadequate resources which might jeopardize future development. And in 2009, land was Macau lends sites from Zhuhai, and they there was also a delineation of land boundary, and the land under the ambit of Macau expanded by three times. And as such, Macau was able to develop tourism and leisure projects, and it showed that the central government fully supported Macau's development as a global tourism node. And that move was even more visionary than the decision in 2002 to expand the development of casinos. And Hong Kong also signed an agreement to develop the Loop area with Shenzhen. And however, it was criticized by certain LegCo members, and some members opposed to it, or the opposition opposed to it, citing transport issues. And because of the opposition camp, Hong Kong's development stagnated. And they also attacked the Hong Kong administration as being useless. And I hope that they can realize the situation and think about the big picture and our general interests. President, in for the policy address every year, the administration has emphasized the importance of housing, and there has been little mentioning of commercial developments and hotel developments at Kai Tak. The planning department suggested developing three sites for housing purposes, and another site would be used for hotel development, and that's why the number of hotel rooms has decreased by 1,000. And for the Caltech Fantasy project, and the administration would launch tendering for certain projects, and we also have a cruise terminal in the area, as well as the Caltech multipurpose sports ground. There would be a 50,000 seater stadium, and we will have a number of performances and concerts as well as sport events. There would be substantial demand for hotel rooms. For certain hotels under planning at the six sites, they enjoy a harbor view, and those are prime hotel sites, and we can appeal to upmarket tourists, and they can help enhance Hong Kong's capacity as a tourism node. And hopefully those hotels can be completed soon. And if we cut back on the number of hotel sites by 3, that would certainly be affected. The government should not rezone the hotel sites as residential areas. And as you know, it takes a long time to construct hotels from tendering or from land identification to completion. It takes at least 3 to 4 years. I request the government to reconsider their decision to rezone these 3 sites, and when necessary, they should redevelop those sites as some service apartments. And under the policy address, the Wan Chai Sports Ground would be converted into convention facilities. And as I understand, district personnel and LegCo members are unhappy with the decision to convert the sports ground, and they are concerned about the they are concerned that community leisure facilities would be affected. And I hope that the government will provide alternative facilities in compensation. The Wan Chai Sports Ground is an important ground for competitions and training. And according to the government's plan, after the commissioning of the Caltech Sports Ground, the major performances and races at the Hong Kong stadium would be moved to the Caltech Sports Ground. But the Hong Kong stadium must be converted or renovated before they can fulfill the purpose. So the government must ensure the smooth transition of events. For the XRL, it would be commissioned by the third quarter of this year, even though the Hong Kong section would only be 26 kilometers in length. The Hong Kong terminus would have 15 platforms, and it will be connected to the XRL network in the mainland. It would be integrated with the 15,000 kilometer railway or XRL network in the mainland. And from Hong Kong to Guangzhou, the travel time will be shortened from 100 minutes to 48. And to Beijing, it will take 8 minutes. To Kunming, 6 hours, to Xiamen, about 4 hours. From the Kowloon terminus, within the 4-hour radius, more than 100 million of population would be covered, including Fujian, Wuhan, etc. From Beijing to Moscow, London, and Paris, the total journey time would only take around 48 hours. It would be possible to take the railway to travel from Hong Kong to London. It would no longer be a dream. It is not just about convenience. The entire connectivity in Greater China would be enhanced, and there would be a super railway network. So before the commissioning of XRL, the government must reach consensus with the mainland authorities in terms of the co-location arrangements. And as it stands, tourists cannot complete the clearance in the West Kowloon terminus. The convenience would be affected for sure. And it would be necessary to set up a boundary crossing point at the border, or else it would be impossible to integrate the XL network with the mainland network.
Only when we have collocation facilities in Hong Kong allowing tourists to complete the clearance procedure for the two places can we really enjoy the high-speed rail service and that the XRL can fulfill its objective. The controversy is how, under the basic law, we can have clearance, custom, inspection, quarantine facilities of the mainland housed in the Hong Kong terminus. We do have precedent, for example, for Eurostar in Europe, the Paris terminus can also allow collocation of the relevant facilities for the two places. And the two governments also worked hard to resolve the issue. Therefore, our authority should discuss actively with the mainland authorities using the example I mentioned as the precedent and discuss how we can resolve the issue. Now, there is another concern about the destinations and the journey times after the commissioning of the XRL. I hope that our government can discuss more expeditiously with the mainland authorities and make public the relevant timetable and the route map so that the business sector can also make preparation and tap business opportunities, and travel agencies can also arrange for the tours, whereas members of the public can also prepare for their traveling plans, because according to some members of the public, they can take XRL to Fujian and Shantou when it's commissioned, because we have close ties with the two places. Even Mr. Gary Chan agrees with me. So XRL is a necessity for us. Well, the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge will be commissioned soon, Mr. President. The journey time will be shortened, and there will be a reorganization of cross-border coaches. At present, we have 600 such coaches per day, and they travel to Hulmen, Panyu, etc. And after its commissioning, after the commissioning of the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge, the majority of passengers would use the border checkpoint there, and the utilization of the Shenzhen Bay BCP would be reduced. The government planned to issue 300 new licenses for cross-border coaches. The sector is of the view that the 100 quotas originally allocated for mainland coaches is not sufficient, because more passengers would be taking the new border checkpoint, and there should be 300 licenses in total. Well, after the commissioning of the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge, it would be more convenient for tourists and also for exchange between the three places. I hope that the government can complete the construction of the bridge more expeditiously. Mr. Jeffrey Lam. Mr. President, I recall when the Chief Executive, Mr. C.Y. Leung, assumed office, his first policy address accorded top priority to housing issues, and that the solution to the problem is to increase land and housing supply. And this policy address, again, accords priority to housing. And I think that the public would agree, the government will proactively develop land for housing supply so that people can get a public housing or buy a home as soon as possible. And one of the initiatives is to rezone conservation areas with low ecological value on the periphery of country parks for public housing. Well, I understand that the green groups will be very will have reservations about the idea, but I think that we should stay calm and be pragmatic, rational, and objective in pondering this issue. The Country Park Ordinance was enacted in 1976. Five country parks were designated: Shengmun, Kamshan, Taitam, Lion Rock, and Aberdeen, covering 432 square kilometers. Eventually, more country parks were included. And now we have 24 country parks designated in Hong Kong and also 17 special sites covering 44,300 hectares, or 40% of our total area in Hong Kong. Well, taking into account other deserted farmland and green belts, it accounts for more than 40% of our total area. Well, country parks is the oasis of our city. I also enjoy country parks, but land resources are limited, especially when Hong Kong is such a small place. We must strike the appropriate balance between conservation and development. For country parks with lower ecological value and with fewer public activities can be rezoned for public housing, then more people would have a roof under their head, including the elderly. Now, isn't it more meaningful? Over the past 4 years, the government has made some progress in identifying land for housing development. And yet, in terms of the quantity and quality of housing production, I think that the public is still not satisfied. Public housing production hasn't met the target. Property prices continue to soar. We no longer see homes selling for $4 million only. And the public is aggrieved. We have also a long average waiting time for PRH applicants. The number of PRH applications have reached a record high, and the whole community is concerned about housing supply. If we cannot increase housing supply in a short period of time, there would be repercussions. By 2039, the population will reach 8.9 million, and according to the existing land use and infrastructural development proposals, by 2039, apart from the projects completed then, we would need an additional 1,500 hectares of land to cope with the projected 8.9 million in our population, or 3.1 million households. The government, therefore, should take a multi-pronged approach and plan for the long-term housing supply in Hong Kong. Developing country parks, of course, is a sensitive issue, especially under this political and social atmosphere. I think that it would be very difficult for government to implement this idea. I hope that the political parties and the concerned groups would consider very seriously the housing needs of the community, and they should not just object to the proposal for the sake of objection. As for the government, if it is in the interest of the public, it should show soldier on in the face of opposition. The other major issue is labor issue. Well, if they get, I understand that the CY Leung administration is committed to increasing housing supply, but my concern is that when there are so many construction projects, I wonder whether we have sufficient manpower in the construction industry to cope with the development projects. We always use the analogy of bread and flour when it comes to housing production. To produce bread, apart from flour, we also need bakers, that is, construction workers. Well, we're in such labor shortage that even with a sufficient amount of flour, we won't be able to produce bread in a short period of time. Developing land and housing involves reclamation and substantial works. And many of the construction workers are in their retirement age. And we also have a very high turnover rate in the industry. So the labor shortage problem is getting more and more serious. My concern is even if the administration is working full steam towards increasing housing and land supply, there will not be sufficient manpower. It will be the obstacle, and by then, many prospective home buyers would be very disappointed. I agree that, of course, the government's labor policy should be to give priority to local workers. And yet, if certain industries are experiencing imminent labor shortage, the government should give some flexibility and allow short-term importation of labor. I understand that the government understands the problem, and therefore the government should face squarely the issue of labor shortage. Apart from stepping up training for industries, the government should also review the labor situation for respective industries. And without affecting local jobs, there should be suitable importation of labor. I want to talk about anti-speculation measures as well. Well, since introduction of the special stamp duty in 2012, we have seen more and more draconian anti-speculation measures in the property market, such that prospective home buyers find themselves more and more difficult in buying a home, because after introduction of the measures, the prospective sellers are reluctant in selling their flats, causing a drop in supply, and the CNI sector do have reservations about the measures, and we should give weight to their views. In order for the property market to develop in a healthy manner, apart from introducing draconian measures to drastically cost a reduction of the number of transactions by 50%, we should consider what happens to the mass market flats. Well, it is hoped that the property prices can be suppressed to a level that people can afford. And yet, the reality is that prospective buyers are unable to buy a home, and tenants are now required to pay higher rent. I want to point out that the anti-speculation measures cannot address the problem at its root. Be it the public or the CNI sector, we all want a healthy and stable property market. And yet, the government should also consider the implications of the draconian measures. We have given our views to the government before. The government should tackle the problem at source. Mr. President, the anti-speculation measures cannot address the housing problem in Hong Kong because the root of the problem lies with increasing land supply. The government should also relax the plot ratio restriction. The community should also support the government's effort in creating land. It is pointless to stop the government from developing land and blame the soaring property prices at the same time. We hope that with increase in housing and land supply, the property market can develop in a healthy manner so that people can have a home.
President, the policy addresser refers to the scrapping of the offsetting arrangement for MPF. In terms of LSP and SP, the BPA has voiced its objection many times. But since the labor sector has been urging the CE to make good on his promises, and he brushed aside the business sector's objection and incorporated this idea into his policy address this year. I'd like to reiterate our opposition to these scrapping mechanism. We will be pursuing the matter and reflect our views to the administration. President, in relation to these scrapping of MPF offsetting, it does all harm and no good to everybody, because many of the employers would be dismissing workers with long service and rehire them, and the employers would have to make provision for this new arrangement. 98% of the businesses are SMEs, and they may not be able to afford the provisions. According to the government's plan, in 10 years' time, the government will be sharing out the costs, and the sharing ratio will be decreased progressively. And in 10 years' time, the employers will have to take over all the responsibilities. And this is wholly unacceptable. The government doesn't have any assessment on the basis of actual data. The administration's proposal to share out some of the costs would be only scratching the surface. The government will share out only a portion for the first year or for and progressively less. And this is nowhere near enough. I think they are trying to sweet talk the labor, the business sector into this deal. And SP and LSP are part of the labor protection. And this is not part of the retirement protection. In the early days, when MPF was put in place, the administration agreed that there is an overlapping between SP, LSP and the MPF. And also, offsetting arrangement was put in place to minimize the employer's costs. An offsetting arrangement is not to take away the workers' contribution or the entitlements. Is just that they're allowed to cash in at an earlier stage. The business sector has always been of the view that there should be a tripartite commitment between the administration, the employers and employees. Retirement protection should be separated out. The government simply cannot accuse the employers of evading their responsibility and bow to populism. The government will, in 10 years' time, this will be of no concern to the administration. They should not think that by scrapping this offsetting arrangement, then they can wash their hands of it. Without any long-term commitment on the part of the government, the retirement protection will not be addressed. President, Hong Kong is becoming increasingly politicized. People are becoming more radical, and there is a resentment against the business community. People are getting more populist the world over. Brexit happened, and President Trump took office. The geopolitical risks are getting higher. We also face the specter of terrorism. The business community is facing internal and external uncertainties, and there are if the offsetting arrangement is scrapped, and if the standardized working hours were to be introduced, there would be increasing the burden of the business community, and this would be detrimental to our competitiveness, and the economy would take a toll on the economy. SMEs margins are getting smaller these days, and profitability is in doubt. The labor legislation is being tightened up. Welfareism and populism are really rising, and the SMEs are facing high operating costs. It is difficult for them to open an account, and there is also the labor shortage. But the administration doesn't do anything to address them. Like the land supply and helping the poor, these are steps in the right direction. In the construction trade, in the old folks' homes, there is a chronic shortage of labor. We're not suggesting that we should import labor for all sectors at the expense of local workers, but the construction workers are not enough, and there is no new blood joining the trade. For the caring sector, it is also running out of labor. Why is it that the administration is reluctant to listen to the business community? In any developed jurisdictions, they have a moderate programs to import labor and also import talents. I hope that in the next few months, more work will be undertaken in this regard. The new chief executive should have regard to the needs of the business community and have a more foresight and improve the quality of life in the interest of a better economy. I am convinced, President, that it is only with a favorable business environment that the economy will flourish. If an economy flourishes, people will have a decent life, and the business community would be happy to reward the community and help those who are in need. But if we pursue welfareism and forcing at the hands of the business community, we will not be able to resolve the deep-seated problems. It will only intensify the social conflicts. Thank you. Mr. Gary Chen. President, before I make my speech, I must heap praise on the Secretariat. Now, this segment is land, housing, transportation, environment, and conservation. Grouping these areas together will enable us to debate the policy address more effectively. If the administration can group these policy areas together, it would certainly facilitate better communication. It would be achieving better results. Now, for development, it cannot be divorced from conservation. Without good conservation, people would be resentful, but without any development, people would be running out of accommodation. If we put these four areas together in the administration, they would be able to take a big leap forward in formulating their policies. So I think development and housing should be put together. I'd like to take this opportunity to say this to the next term of administration, whoever becomes the chief executive, and these two areas should be amalgamated. If housing and development are put into one single bureau with an element of conservation, then it would be good for developing new towns and also for conservation areas of high conservation value. This administration is coming to the end of his tenure before the chief executive took office. He said that he would give priority to housing, and people did pin very high hope on him. Although the property prices remain high, the rents remain high, the new housing production is not as expected. The waiting time for PRHG is more than 4 years. But the current administration has indeed displayed unprecedented vigor in identifying land. So many of the CE contenders made the point that they would continue with the housing policies. Now, there are some officials who indicated their intention to continue their service, and I hope that they will be able to do something, to have something to show for it in the next administration and continue with this good housing policy. In the previous administration, people criticized it for not having any vision. Now, the government launched this 2030-plus mapping out the vision for the future, and Hong Kong will be turned into a livable city. And this has addressed some of the public aspiration. This term, livable, in the policy address 2013, it was livable was used. At that time, the chief executive sought to provide a bigger living space for the people of Hong Kong. There is some fine-tuning in this regard. Not only are we talking about the size of the living space, the quality of life would also be important. It is understandable for the government to have this adjustment. Land supply is subject to a lot of constraints. But I hope that because of the tight land supply, the government should not cave in to the problems. There are so many coven units, or the ultra-small-sized units. If we cannot resolve the living space, then there is no way we can start talking about the quality of life. Over the years, in the council, I have been pursuing the matter with the administration and asked them how we can resolve this worsening housing problem. How can the government help the residents who are in dire straits? During the Lunar New Year, in the private sector market, the rents have been dramatically increased. Now, anyone earning $20,000-$30,000 per month is spending the lion's share of the pay for rent. I'm not sure how they can survive. The waiting time for PRH is now 4.7 years, and a lot of people who are living in subdivided units or partitioned units or the coffined cubicles, and they are really struggling to stay afloat. So the only problem, the only solution to the problem is to increase land supply. Where is land going to come from? I admire SHIU Ka-chun for the generating discussion on developing the country parks. Now, this is a debatable, a controversial issue. Instead of causing this controversy, why do we not pick the low-hanging fruits and get on with the brownfield sites? If we do not take measures regarding brownfields first, then it will be difficult for the public to accept any development on in country parks. In the policy address, the administration said that there would be a survey on the brownfields in Hong Kong. Now, this is something that we suggested them many times, and this is something the government ought to do. Otherwise, we would end up with a situation where many of the opposition members are using spurious arguments, and they're saying that we should have brownfields first. They display a map and say that there are so many brownfields in the North District. if we compare the brownfields with the Northeast NT project, they are advocating for Pingche and Fanling. And I think it's the case of head I win, tails you lose, as far as they are concerned. I think instead of making accusations like this, instead of spearing the administration, I think the secretary would show the opposition a map that the brownfields are precisely the areas that the government is going to be developing on, the Pingche and Taku Link, and they should not continuously smear the administration and blindly accuse the government of blindly grabbing land.
Whenever we talk about brownfield development, we must first consider the existing brownfield operations or people who live on brownfield sites. Without a comprehensive compensation plan, I'm sure the government will run into great difficulties when developing these brownfield sites. And the time required for development would also be lengthened. And at the end, those waiting to be housed would be affected when developing new areas. The government must compensate the affected operators or residents under the existing compensation mechanism. I do not think that the residents would leave after receiving the compensation because they would not be able to afford properties or find somewhere to continue their businesses or operations. This would only lead to even more conflicts. Therefore, the government should adopt more flexibility and offer more reasonable incentives in order for merchants and residents to move out voluntarily. For housing and development, the Development Bureau has no housing resources to provision affected residents. At the end, they have to look to the THB for HOS or PRH flats. If the Development Bureau is able to offer housing resources to reprovision affected residents, I'm sure that the reprovisioning efforts would be much smoother. And in an earlier policy address, the chief executive, Mr. Leung, said they would improve the housing ladder for the public. However, as we can see, this ladder is yet to be built. You can see that the government's focus is on controlling short-term housing demand in terms of increasing supply in the long run. That is of secondary priority. So the government is not able to fulfill the 3-year public housing target, and the production of private flats is also way below expectation. The government should reconsider offering the first-time buying arrangement in order to fulfill the target of housing residents within 3 years. In the current policy address, there was an emphasis on conservation. A conservation fund would be set up. This is something the DAB has been angling for a number of years. In the new territories, a lot of ecologically important sites and buildings are owned by private landlords. If you only think about conservation, you would deprive the owners of their rights. If you are to develop land and buildings, then you might lose the conservation value. So the proposed conservation fund can indeed alleviate the conflicts between conservation and development. So in the Xiaolaotong project, the government will set up a preparatory committee to further rural rehabilitation efforts, and I'm greatly supportive of the plan. I hope that the pilot scheme can be extended to other areas as well. For instance, after the UK implemented a conservation fund for castles of ecological or historical value, they would be assessed, and the government would purchase the entire castle for it would be handed over to NGOs for conservation, and this way the public can also know about its history. So this would be a win-win situation for the public, government, and landlords. It should be done as soon as possible. So now we are moving into the issue of conservation. The policy address this year also address the UN Climate Change Convention in France, and a steering committee was set up, and 1 year on, this year's policy address mentioned the report submitted by the chief secretary last year on the government's climate change mitigation methods, and by 2030, the carbon intensity would be reduced by 65% to 70% by the year 2030. And in terms of the long-term mitigation measures and carbon reduction target, last month, the administration announced the Hong Kong Climate Change Plan 2030 Plus, or Action Plan 2030 Plus. And it was a action plan aimed at achieving carbon reduction target, and I'm sure that the efforts of different departments would be needed in order to achieve such target. A proactive approach must be adopted. And in this year's policy address, the chief executive also mentioned the increased use of renewable energy, including the investment of $200 million to install renewable energy at government buildings, for example, solar power. In the development of renewable energy, Hong Kong's neighbors have steamed ahead. They are not just adopting RE in government buildings, but also in private properties. For the mainland government, in 2009, they launched a project called Golden Sun. So they installed solar panels at the rooftops of buildings where possible, and the government would provide funding and subventions. These solar facilities would also be installed at public places in order to promote renewable energy. Whereas in Hong Kong, and the WSD would only install solar panels and floating panels at certain sites or reservoirs, so we are really lagging behind. The extensive installation of solar panels might lead to cost recovery concerns, but we can see that solar energy technologies have taken leaps and bounds, and I'm sure the recovery period would be much shorter. If you only consider cost, then you would lose sight of their social significance. This is not just a conservation initiative, but also it's also about education and social advocacy. So in terms of renewable energy, solar energy, etc., the government should not be too passive. instead they should try to increase the proportion of RE in Hong Kong. I'd also like to talk about waste management strategy, and I understand that Mr. Wong Kam Sing would soon brief LESCO on solid waste charging. And earlier, the Secretary told the media that the coming waste charging policy would mean that each family would have to pay $1 or $2 per day for waste charging. If we implement the policy, each family has to pay $1 to $2 per day. For the secretary, it might be a very small sum, but then it would come to $60 per month for grassroots families. This is a rather big burden. So when establishing the fees, the secretary should consider the affordability of these families. Of course, using financial means to improve the livelihoods of families would be effective, but you should also consider their affordability. Otherwise, your plan would not be would not work well. And that's why I hope the secretary would consider that carefully. Apart from waste charging, you should consider whether community recycling facilities are adequate and whether you can reduce waste at source, and so on and so forth. And these have been discussed sufficiently before, so I won't repeat myself. As for the charges collected, I hope that the secretary would use the charges collected on promoting recycling, waste collection, and so on, in order to develop Hong Kong's waste management strategy. Thank you. Mr. Peter Chiu. Thank you. In terms of conservation, I'd like to thank Mr. Wong, the Secretary for Environment. A few years ago, Hong Kong had a lot of smog very often, but in recent years, we can see the clear sky again. And I believe that the Environment Bureau has done a lot in this regard by cooperating with the mainland. And this is something Hong Kong people can see, so I'd like to thank them for that. And as a newly elected legislator, whenever the government implemented a new policy, there's always a major reaction from the trade. And in terms of recycling, and the trade said they have accepted a lot of the measures or proposals. I think the government should discuss with different stakeholders every time, instead of just single-handedly implementing policies. Otherwise, there would be a big backlash. And the director of EMSD, Mr. Chen, is one of the better officials I have seen at different events. And the trade has expressed their appreciation of the director. For the beauty services trade, we are talking about 1,000 or 2,000 practitioners. Well, this is something I will discuss with Dr. Koh later on. In terms of transport, I have a message for Professor Anthony Cheung. For MTR or other modes of mass transport, I agree with this general strategy. Earlier, the government implemented a $2 concession scheme for the elderly, and I'm sure that this is a good policy with enough support. And for buses, Taiwan has been implementing bus arrival information or panels for a number of years, this is something you should promote so that passengers can tell how long they have to wait. So hopefully the government can do it as soon as possible. In terms of the co-location arrangements, well, this is not easy, I'm sure, but Professor Cheung, you must persevere, and you must think about connectivity with the mainland network. So hopefully Professor Cheung can do something.
Well, for the, as far as the Development Bureau is concerned, I really have a lot to say to Mr. Ma, the Secretary, because the major problem in Hong Kong now is housing. And I share the view of the other member. In the past, we used to talk about flour, but apart from flour, we also need bakers. And flower means land. I understand that this policy address has put forward some bold ideas. Well, reclamation outside Victoria Harbour, I support that. But of course, you may face opposition from green groups, the divers. Well, then you should tell them what the tenants living in subdivided units are suffering. And also for country parks and in remote areas, the utilization rate is so low. We don't know where these places are, about unleashing the potential of brownfield sites. Again, I agree, but you need to work with the stakeholders such as the transportation, logistics industry. You need to help them reposition. Now, you may touch upon farmland as well, and you may need to tackle this issue. Again, you need to tell them that you have 300,000 people waiting for public housing and also people living in caged homes and subdivided units. You need to tell them that. Apart from flour, well, we also need to talk about bakers, and that is manpower. We didn't used to talk about this, but we're now almost in full employment. And we have labor shortage in various industries, retail, catering, transportation. And Mr. Frankie Yik the other day said that the minibus drivers are now having an average age of 70, far beyond their retirement. Let's compare ourselves with other countries such as Singapore. 1.4%, 1.4 million foreign labor. Macau, also over 10%. What about Hong Kong? Just a few percent. Well, we also have labor, members representing the labor sector. But in fact, we already have foreign labor. We have 300,000 foreign domestic helpers in Hong Kong. Should they be regarded as imported labor? Well, I think we all have an answer in our mind. If we are really to exclude foreign domestic helpers, imported laborers, then who would be taking care of the children? Even the female members of this council would have to go back to take care of their children. So if you want to improve productivity, if you want to unleash the potential of women in our population for them to join the workforce, you rely on foreign domestic helpers. So for construction workers, well, we're not, we don't envy these workers. They may be bar fixers, etc. They may earn $2,000 a day. Well, but we're concerned about the per square foot cost of construction. It has risen from $2,000 to $5,000 per square foot. And a large proportion of the cost has to do with labor. So how can you build cheap flats? Well, of course, labor importation has to do with the Secretary for Labor, Labor and Welfare, but I think that the Secretary for Development should send this message to him. If we don't have sufficient labor, how can we increase production? Now, labor importation may affect local wages for local workers, but I want to send this message to the public as well. While these workers may be earning slightly over $10,000, it may be the wages are higher now, but they don't benefit from it at all because of the high property price. And also, well, Mr. President, I think I'll soon reach the age of 60, and then and then we have very low productivity because of the dependency ratio. And I don't think the public would agree that we should drive away the foreign domestic helpers. So we really need to think about labor importation. If they come to Hong Kong, if they then obtain the status as Hong Kong residents, we may be concerned. But we're only talking about imported labor. Say, if the economy takes a downturn, if locals are losing their jobs, we can just take away their visas. We don't renew their visas, and they would be sent home. Well, say we have a quota. We have a quota of 150 for mainlanders on a one-way permit, and they would enjoy the status as Hong Kong residents. But that's not the case for foreign labor. We give them a visa for a year or two, and if they stay beyond that, they would be arrested and sent home. We just need manpower. I hope that the administration would consider very seriously the idea of labor importation. Mr. Martin Yao. Mr. President, well, I'd like to talk about energy policy in this session. This year, the policy address has little mentioning of this issue. Well, under the chapter on climate change, the policy address states that more renewable energy would be used to phase out coal-fired generation units by 2030, and there would also be discussion with the two power companies on the scheme of control agreements for increasing use of renewable energy. It is true that the 10-year scheme of control agreement will soon expire for the two power companies. At present, 70% of the power is generated from coal-fired generation units. And the upcoming negotiation will include whether we can increase our undertaking for the use of renewable energy. And the target is to reduce carbon intensity by 65% to 70% by 2030, comparing to 2005 level. Energy is a necessity for daily activities as well as the business sector. Increase in electricity tariff will pose a greater burden on the general public as well as the SMEs. The two power companies dominate the energy market, and they therefore have a high degree of social corporate responsibility. And the government should also impose suitable regulation on the energy market for the interests of the public. Energy policy, therefore, is an important livelihood and economic issue, and we must consider the issue thoroughly. When Mr. Wong, Secretary for Environment, gave us a briefing on the policy address, he talked about a number of initiatives. For example, lowering the permitted rate of return for the two power companies in the next scheme of control agreement, and there would be a new mechanism to compel the power companies to use renewable energy, and there would also be he would also pave way for a newcomer in the energy market. Now, the common refrain, Mr. President, is that if we want cleaner energy, there would be a pressure for a tariff increase. And yet, the mechanism is already subject to a lot of criticisms. But the two power companies have proposed a reduction in electricity charges, but in fact, the charges increase as a result. The two power companies increased the charges by 3.7 and 3.2% respectively. That the reduction was a result of the additional fuel cost charges that the two companies impose. And as a result, they propose a reduction of 2% or 17.2% for the two companies. In fact, at present, the scheme of control agreement allows a permitted rate of return of 9.99% as the cap. Is it too high? The independent consultant commissioned by the government reviewed the rate of return capital and the cost of borrowing and suggested that the permitted rate of return should be reduced to 6 to 8%. Is it possible under the new scheme of control agreement? And also, at the moment, fuel costs are directly charged onto consumers at the moment, meaning that the risk would be directly transferred to members of the public. The public is looking forward to the next scheme of control agreement, in which the government will have this opportunity to explore new ways and use and promote the use of renewable energy. RE will help stabilize electricity tariff. According to the CPU study conducted a number of years ago, we do have great potential of developing solar energy. If we allow solar panels to be installed on rooftop of buildings, the electricity generated will account for 1% of total energy consumption in Hong Kong, and it can also be promoted and have a greater share of in the energy mix. And yet we're lagging behind. In Seoul, in recent years, the government has required power companies to invest $5 billion to develop solar energy. Members of the public can also purchase funds to invest in the relevant items. And the government introduced Solar Nova a number of years ago so that private operators can apply for the operation through public tender, and the public can also take part in the fundraising or crowdfunding campaign. Apart from installing RE facilities on the rooftops, I think the public would also like to see a blueprint on how the government can support green finance and renewable energy. Mr. Ben Chen.
Thank you, Mr. President. Well, this motion is on motion of thanks for the Chief Executive's policy address. We had quite a hard time in the previous debates. I hope that since this policy address is a pragmatic one, there would be support in this council. And I'd also like to take this opportunity to highlight a number of issues. I see some good points in this policy address. For example, the government has laid out this plan in increasing housing supply, and there will be also other policies such as reindustrialization. After Mr. Donald Trump is elected the US president, he also emphasizes reindustrialization. Well, last month, there was a motion debate moved by me on the Hong Kong PSG, and I'd like to talk about housing and transportation. whenever there is housing development, the government would always face opposition during consultation. And the opposition mainly came from the transport perspective. So I think that the government hasn't been doing a good job in tackling transportation and housing issues. If you've been to Yunlong, you would know that Yunlong used to be sparsely populated. It was spacious. But Secretary, if you happen to go to Yunlong during weekends, you will feel how crowded it is. And if you are driving, you will feel trapped because of the serious congestion.
And the quality of life has been compromised. I would agree that if the government put in place a good planning for transport, it would be good for Yunlong. East Kowloon is a case in point. The construction of the East Kowloon line will link up Kwun Tong with the Diamond Hill Station of the Sha Tin Central Line and also Po Lam Station. This is running in parallel with the another rail line, and this railway line can link up with Jordan and Anderson Road. There are 37,000 people moving, who are moving in this area, and they, by the time they move in, they would enjoy good town planning. I hope that while the government considers this railway line, it would be bolder to extend this all the way to Po Lam, Clearwater Bay, and the HKUST, or even Sai Kung. Over the weekend, the traffic is pretty congested all the way to Sai Kung. There is only one access road, and once congestion happens, the traffic would be grinding to a complete halt. And the HKUST is generating a lot of traffic demand. And Hong Kong HKUST is not served by any rail a rail line. If we can extend the line by 1 kilometer, then we can serve the HKUST and create a kind of a hub there. This would improve the traffic situation no end. I mentioned Kowloon East Line because I've been looking at this. Now, we have seen an increase in population, but the railway has not. In Hongshukyo, there will be a 60,000 units, 60,000 in Kwutong North, altogether 140,000 housing units. If you take into account a topside development, private development, we're going to have 200,000 units being built with 600,000 to 700,000 more people. The West Rail has increased the number of cars to 7, and there will be an increase of 14% patronage. With the Sha Tin Central Line, we're going to see an increase in patronage of 37%. NT West, Yunlong, Tuen Mun, Tin Sui Wai, at the moment we have a population of 1.3 million and 410,000 will be using the West Rail, or 30% of the people. If we have an additional 600,000 to 700,000 people added to the population, we're going to have an increase of 200,000. At the moment, it is 410,000 using the West Rail. We're going to have 200,000 more using the West Rail, or 25% rise. Now, we also have the Tuen Mun South extension. I cited all these figures to show that the West Rail simply cannot cope with Yunlong South and Kamtin South and Kwutong North. All the population increase there, you cannot cope. You put the population there, you're not serving them with the railway system. It is an irresponsible town planning approach. So the Tsuen Wan District Councils back 10 years ago suggested the government consider a railway linking Tsuen Wan and Tsuen Wan. Now this is important because if you ever used West Rail, you understand that the vast majority of people would be getting off at Tsuen Wan. The Tsuen Wan Tsuen Wan railway will be running along the coast. It would cover So Kwun Fat. A lot of land there can be released for housing production. And along Castle Peak Road, you can travel all the way to Tsuen Wan and link up with the Tsuen Wan line. And then you can travel to Kwai Chung and pick up the line to Sha Tin. So the East Rail, West Rail, and Tsuen Wan line can be linked up by this Tsuen Wan Tsuen Wan line. If any incidents happen on the railway, this Tsuen Wan Tsuen Wan line would serve a very good link, and this would provide a very good buffer against any incidents. The government rejected this idea for the high costs. It is costly because there will be reclamation because it is on the coast. Indeed, there are other options that are less costly. The population served by the Tsuen Wan Tsuen Wan line will be higher than the southern island line. Why do you build the South Island line and not the Tsuen Wan Tsuen Wan line? The government hasn't come up with any justifications for not doing it. Now, some argue that there should be a rail linking Tsuen Wan with Lantau and also all the way to Kennedy Town. If we have a railway spanning over the ocean or the sea, it would be difficult to get it off the ground. So the NT-West has seen an increase in population. We cannot sit around and wait for this cross-harbor tunnel. Route 11 will experience a great deal of difficulties because there will be consultations. Now, when the residents were consulted on Route 10, there were strong oppositions. We welcome the resurrection of Route 11, but I don't think we can underestimate the difficulties. Tsuen Wan, Tsuen Wan Railway, both district councils are in agreement. I don't think the Sha Tin district council would raise an objection. In the 2014 railway development study, the government has removed this proposal. And you are putting so much population there, you ought to do something about the situation. The other thing is parking. Now, I mentioned this when we talked about the Hong Kong Planning Standard and Guidelines. The registered vehicles has increased from 690 to 810, or 18% rise. Roads, we're going to see an increase of 0.8%. In 2020, the road infrastructure development will be decreasing, only a growth of 0.4%. So statistically, the growth in vehicles has outpaced the growth in the number of roads. The consequences are road congestion. In terms of parking, in 1995, the government completed a report. In 2002, they conducted another report. 15 years on, the administration has not updated the measures. They are suggesting merely that by limiting the growth in parking spaces, they can limit the growth in vehicles. But this measure of curbing vehicle growth by curbing the number of car parking spaces has proved to be a failure. Otherwise, why is it that we have seen such a dramatic rise in private vehicles? If the government carries on with this policy, then it would be a non-starter. It would not be able to address the problem at all. Say, for instance, recently I visited some of the car parks, Kwailun Estate, 1,400 units, and no parking spaces. Lower Kwaichung Estate, there will be 600 or so units to be built. We can imagine how many car parks that we provided. The number is 16 for 600 units. And there may be limousine drivers, and there may be professional drivers. If no parking spaces are provided, they will just park them in the short-term tenancy car parks. And the rent has gone up from $2,000 to $4,000 per month. In the new developments under the HKPSG, within 500 meters of the railway, there will be a big reduction in the provision of car parks. I don't know where they can park their cars. I've talked with one of the former planners, and I was told that in Tsim Sha Tsui there was an official who spent 2 years considering how to discourage people from driving into Tsim Sha Tsui. The solution would be not to provide parking spaces. And as a result, we end up with Tsim Sha Tsui, which is chock-a-block with traffic. And eventually he decided against not providing parking spaces in Tsim Sha Tsui. Now we can see that in Tsim Sha Tsui there are buildings that are not provided with parking. And that was due to the failure of the old days planning. On holidays, if you visit Taipo, Chunwan, Yunlong, these are some way off, away from the urban areas. I mean, we see congestion there because of a lack of parking spaces, and the government is putting a lot of population there. Now, if you look at the parking spaces for people to park and ride, they are fully used. Now, people may be parking at Canteen, West Rail Station, and then get on the West Rail, but it is fully parked. The DAP has made suggestions over the years regarding car parking facilities. They never took on board our suggestions. The government said that they will review the parking spaces for commercial vehicles. Why don't you review the parking spaces for private vehicles as well? If you merely address the commercial vehicles, you're going to have the private vehicles parked all over the place in Hong Kong, and that would be no different from the commercial vehicles being parked all over the place. The government is burying its head in the sand in this regard. They said that there may be other policies according to the TAC's recommendation to disincentivize people from from my car ownership. But does the solution lie with distributing more tickets to the motorists? People would be resentful that they buy a car and then they would expect parking spaces. Now, a lot of parking spaces are converted into plots for building houses. There are some districts where the parking spaces are dramatically reduced by 3,000. There is a mismatch there, and this problem is going to be with us for a long time to come. If the administration doesn't improve the planning there the problem is going to be with us going forward. In the policy address, and there is mention of the pedestrian-friendly policy, make it smart and make it enjoyable, make it safe and make it enjoyable, and all these are the policies with regard to the policy. Now, I welcome this universal accessibility program, but since 2014, the government proposed lifts, retrofitting some of the slopes with lifts, and people can get access to the MTR station. 10 years on, this retrofitting lift program has been moving very, very slowly. Some lifts have been provided, but they're not provided for under the government's project. Why is it that other projects can proceed so quickly, whereas the government's projects are moving so slowly?
A number of escalators are still waiting, and a lot of districts are waiting for the government to build one for them. This way, they would not have to wait endlessly for mini buses, and they wouldn't have to walk down slope. An elderly lady told me that when she was younger, she could use a slope, but she is now just 60 years old, and she cannot carry a lot of things right now. And she said the government has been talking about an escalator for 10 years, but nothing happened. So I think the public has been waiting for too long. So hopefully the government can come up with some sort of compromise, and that is to set up a fund for escalators on slopes. A regular fund should be made available for these facilities in order to expedite the construction of such facilities. If we have a dedicated fund, it would be much faster than waiting for public works funds. We have more than 9,000 capital works or public works this year, and they have yet to be approved after so many hours. How much time do you think would be needed for such a minor district work? So how can we wait? And a small escalator project would not be vetted until it was mentioned in the policy address. So I think this fund for escalators is very important. The government can dedicate, say, $5 billion for this fund. And this way, the government can realize the pedestrian-friendly policy. For other questions, I will wait for other sessions. Thank you. Mr. Wong Kwok-kin, President. This year, the Chief Executive announced his final policy address, as well as the final address in his personal capacity. Since he assumed office in 2012, of the attacks and criticisms on him, they never ceased. Today, we are debating the motion of thanks, and it is still the same. The attacks have persisted. President, behind these attacks and criticisms, some of them might not have been personal, but very often they were highly personal, and the objective is to smear the chief executive and demonize the chief executive. And the result is that policy making in the past 5 years have been extremely difficult, and the society has become divisive. A lot of major projects have been stalled or even shelved or overturned. One classic example was at the chief executive proposal to restructure the hierarchy of the government was shelved, and the highly anticipated Innovation and Technology Bureau could not be realized until the fourth year of his term. But I think he has no more time to realize his plans. Over the last 5 years, a lot of conflicts and have been attributed to CY Leung's personality, but nothing can be owed to a single factor. Is that his sole responsibility, or are they due to more complicated political issues? Are the Pan Democrats also to blame? I'm sure the clever Hong Kong people would have an answer for themselves. Since Mr. CY Leung decided not to seek a second term, the opposition camp continued their attacks on CY's successors, and that's why they came up with the pseudo proposition of CY 2.0, and apparently anything or anyone associated with CY Leung is negative, and they would distance themselves from that. CY Leung faced great difficulties in his policy making over 5 years, and a lot of his policies or measures could only be implemented in the latter part of his reign. If the next term administration do not follow up on that, would it mean that our efforts in the past 5 years were all in vain, and that everything must be started anew? Sustainability is a buzzword nowadays. Does the public want to see changes every single day? This is something the incoming CE must consider. If we do not continue our measures, if no one would extend or continue what CY Leung has done, would the old age living allowance, which was implemented by CY Leung, be cancelled? Would the green subsidized housing scheme be suspended? And are we going to stop developing land? Will we no longer invest on innovation and technology? The new chief executive must continue the work and improve upon it. This is only natural. For worthwhile measures, for example, the poverty alleviation, elderly and housing policies, as well as the cancellation of the MPF offsetting arrangement, these must be extended and improved upon. Some people are criticizing these measures as a continuation of CY Leung. This is unfair to the current and next term administrations. Housing is the top priority of the current term administration. In recent years, there was an abundance of capital as well as low interest rates. The previous administrations did not make timely adjustments on housing policy. We could expect rising property prices during the current term. In a lot of other places, including Europe, US, Australia, and the mainland, their property prices have also been rising, just like Hong Kong. This is due to the quantitative easing in Europe and US. And in this regard, the current term administration has worked very hard around this issue, and they have resumed the construction of public housing, and they have launched schemes such as GSH, and they have relaunched the housing ladder of public and private housing, and this should be acknowledged. In terms of controlling property prices, the current administration has been determined, and they have changed the mechanism for offering public housing, and they have controlled speculation activities, and they have replanned the long-term housing strategy and came up with a long-term housing target. And these are all measures implemented by the current term administration. The incoming administration and chief executives should extend the work and improve upon them in order to come up with better housing developments. President, some people might say that the administration work is meaningless because property prices continue to rise, and the waiting time for public housing has increased from 3 years to 4.7 years. But on the other hand, if we did not implement such measures, what kind of housing issues will Hong Kong be facing? In recent years, the government's move to increase housing supply have faced different difficulties. The construction of building blocks have faced a backlash, and there were criticisms of the government's development of country parks instead of working with brownfield sites. Hong Kong does need to develop land. The previous term administration had no land reserve, and as such, the responsibility fell upon the current term administration. So now we it's a case of deja vu. The incoming administration is already facing the same criticism, and the development of land would involve different stakeholders, so the work is extremely difficult for Northeast NT. The development has faced great opposition, and the same goes for Lantau development. And for the Central Waters Artificial Island and the relevant reclamation, as well as the development of sites of lower ecological interest, they all face opposition, so nothing could be done. So in this regard, how can we increase land supply? Those who propose developing brownfield sites or rural areas might know very well that these sites involve very complicated private ownership, and a lot of time would be required to sort them out. Moreover, would these sites alone be able to solve the housing dilemma? And we have a lot of significant economic activities at these brownfield sites, including logistics, recycling, warehouses, etc. While developing brownfield sites, the government must identify land for these operations. Housing development is not just about construction of buildings. We also need community facilities, and they are all interrelated. That's why long-term planning and determination would be necessary. The current term administration faced a lot of difficulties, but I can see the CE's determination in housing development. At the very least, they came up with short, medium to long-term measures, and this is something we must acknowledge. For the incoming CE, he or she must step up efforts to develop housing, and they cannot allow the property sectors or developers to dominate. A lot of people are criticizing the government because the harder you criticize, the more support you will receive. And therefore, more and more people are criticizing, and as such, the government did not dare to make a move. Now, the current term administration faced a lot of such criticisms. But would criticisms lead us anywhere in terms of development, or should we all contribute and play a part? Or should people begin to accept olive branches and start contributing. So when we, as we judge the policy address and Mr. CY Leung or the incoming CEE, you should not just be criticizing. You should instead offer a helping hand to help Hong Kong. Otherwise, no matter who the incoming CEE will be, Hong Kong's deep-rooted issues will still exist. Thank you.
Mr. Tan Hui.
Thank you, Madam Deputy. Now, on environment, I'd like to talk about the policy address, this proposal to develop country parks. That's what Mr. Wong Kok Kin was referring to. Let me cite the other side of the argument. If you refer to paragraph 113 to 116 of the policy address, one might think that CY Leung has finally changed his mind. For example, in paragraph 113, it says that in 2013, the government included Saiwan in incorporated Saiwan in into a country park, and also in another paragraph, to underpin the sustainable development and conservation, the government would seek to conserve and revitalize the ecology and culture of rural areas based on the sustainability principle and respond to the aspirations of urban dwellers for urban-rural symbiosis. And yet, in the next paragraph, paragraph 117, CY Leung said that the land on the periphery of country parks with relatively low ecological and public enjoyment value for purposes other than real estate development such as public housing or non-profit making elderly homes, and that this issue matters to the well-being of our next generation and warrants serious deliberation of its pros and cons by the society. Now, the Democratic Party's view is this. We don't think there is a need to develop country parks in Hong Kong. In the new territories, we have many deserted agricultural sites. As long as the government is willing to come up with compensation arrangements, many such sites will become available. If the government is willing to review those leases, then the government will be able to acquire these sites for housing development. When delivering the policy address, CY Leung on the TV program mentioned that developing the periphery of country parks will not require public money. If we allow topside development of railway stations, we can subsidize such development, and it is hoped that housing issues can be addressed as soon as possible. That sounds attractive. However, when CY Leung was asked why he opted for developing country parks instead of brownfield sites, he said that the government is willing to develop brownfield sites, but then the brownfield sites are now subject to different uses, and it is difficult to release these sites. And then the program host asked why the Fanling Golf Course would not be developed. He said that the government has given an undertaking, and there are a lot of trees to be felled. Well, I hadn't realized until then that CY Leung cares so much about trees. For the Cardigan Street in Western District, temporary sitting outer area, well, 100 trees were felled in an instant. Well, when we heard about CY Leung's response, we couldn't help but think that the government has decided not to develop Wan Chau for public housing, not because of other reasons, but for the rural forces in control of the place, and also for the Falun Gong
golf course. Again, it's not for trees, it's for the rich and powerful. I think that the public will pass its own judgment on whether there is collusion among the government, business, rural and tribe forces. And we also have 930 hectares of land reserved for village-type development, another 1,000 hectares of land in the hands of developers, together with brownfield sites in the new territories. The Democratic Party thinks that the government should give priority to developing these sites. For example, deserted farmland should be resumed under the Land Resumption Ordinance for public housing. The public's view is that the country park should only be the last resort when no alternative is available. And country park is not just a lawn, as some people suggest. There we have designated statutory, we have statutory procedures to designate country parks. They should not be scrapped casually. If country parks can be demolished, then in a way the government is encouraging damage to the environment. And as a result, the public would follow suit, and then we will see a repeat of the Namsan Wai fire or the garbage hill in Kingswood. Was there any prosecution? How many cases were prosecuted? Or is it that after the environment was is damaged, you would say that since the ecological value is low anyway, we should use it for housing? I think the government should reach a consensus with various sectors of the community in a consultation process. The government should not only engage in soft lobbying with the plutocrats and rural forces. But of course, this government has such low popularity that it cannot do any of this. The next administration should learn a lesson from what Chi-wai Leung has done, and it should find other ways of addressing the land issue other than developing country parks in Hong Kong. Coming back to trees, well, I think Chi-wai Leung mentioned in the policy address the issue surrounding incense trees, and I agree that we should be concerned. The species of trees is being substantially stolen and felled in large amount. Well, at present, the police could only arrest the culprits for theft, and yet it is an endangered species, and the current legislation and enforcement approach cannot reflect how serious the problem is. In terms of enforcement policy, the law enforcement agency and the administration should review the approach. But of course, when Chi-wai Leung said that so many trees will be felled if we develop the golf course, I have to ask, what about tree legislation? Because the public will have this perception that the felling trees will be okay if it is for development. If trees, some trees impose a risk, they should be felled, like the tree in Bonham Road for Central and Western District. The residents felt disheartened because this day, century-old tree had been felled, and it's an old and valuable tree. At the same time, we should also protect the life and property of the public. When will the government enact the tree legislation to protect people as well as trees and protect them, trees, from being felled before we see a repeat of all the accidents involving pregnant women and senior citizens and children? And I think we need an explanation from Chi-wai Leung. this policy address also touches on the topic of legislating for a ban on trading in endangered species, and ivory trade will also be phased out by legislation. I welcome this initiative. I hope the administration will start this work as soon as possible to ban a sale or trading of endangered species, shark species, and the consultation should be rolled out as soon as possible. The public should be encouraged to change their habit of consuming shark fins. Coming to conservation and heritage, we must do more in terms of heritage conservation. We see a major flaw in our policy. We have aged buildings, and yet, because they're not kept well, the government believes that there is no need to conserve the buildings. For example, in Cochrane Street in Central, we have an aged building, but the outlook is not good. The government then said that it should be demolished. And the other example is the Hong Kong Post general office in Central. It is part of the history of Central. It shows among the cluster of buildings in the area, the history of Central, and yet the government said that despite this, it is well maintained, it's not old enough, and again, it should be demolished. And some buildings meet all the relevant requirements, and yet because of a private title, it cannot be conserved, such as the Houghton Garden. And also, we have declared monument, and that is the Central Police Compound, which has been passed on to a private operator for conservation, and yet it has collapsed. Well, even if it's graded grade 1 or grade 2, it can still be demolished, such as the Queen's Pier and also the Emperor Theatre. Well, let's see if the government can stand up to the pressure for private developer. Well, in the whole grading process, we see the composition. We look at the composition of the AAB and the deliberations. I don't think that it is professional because some members do not have a professional background in the relevant field, and after all, they're just long supporters. They only consider the heritage significance of these buildings from the perspective of GFA and the economic value. And the AAB has been criticized for not being professional, and there has also been intervention or interference from the private sector, leading to some wrong decisions made. Many local and foreign and international experts have counter-argued, and the government dares not engage them in the debate and explain the position in public. In terms of other policy areas, I will leave them till the next debate, next session.